Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. Today's program is a conversation with the authors of Voices from Srebrenica, Survivor Narratives of the Bosnian Genocide. Features Hasan Hasanović, head of research at the Srebrenica Genocide Memorial and himself a survivor, as well as Ann Petrila, professor of practice and coordinator of global initiatives at the University of Denver's Graduate School of Social Work. Today's event is presented in partnership with the Center for the Study of Genocide and Human Rights at Rutgers University, the Nancy and David Wolf Holocaust and Humanity Center in Cincinnati, the Holocaust Genocide and Interfaith Education Center at Manhattan College, the Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, the Harriman Institute at Columbia University, and the Genocide Studies Program at Yale University. Please also be sure to submit your questions via the Q&A feature on your screen, as the chat has been disabled for security reasons. Today's conversation is as much about forced displacement, war, and extermination as it is about survival, resistance, and hope. It's also about pushing beyond the atrocity lens when talking about the Srebrenica genocide. But it also marks a very personal moment for me because Han and Hasan are dear colleagues and close friends. It was during my first trip to the Srebrenica Genocide Memorial in July of 2010 when the trajectory of my life changed. That's when I met Hasan, who has had a profound impact about how I see the world, teaching me about grace, courage, and resilience. And it's through Hasan that I met Ann, who has served as a guiding light over the years as we've attempted to both process our multiple experiences in Bosnia. Ann, Hasan, and I have spent countless hours together over the years, journeying to some of the most horrific places in Srebrenica, including accompanying the mothers of Srebrenica on July 13th to many of the execution sites. But we've also spent just as many hours breaking the fast during iftar, drinking coffee, and talking about our lives over the years each time we see each other. There are few people that know me in the world better, and it's one of the reasons they call me Lori. Now, before we begin, I'd like to give you a brief overview of the events leading up to the genocide in Srebrenica. The 1992 to 1995 Bosnian War has its roots in the collapse of what's then known the Socialist Federal Republic of Yugoslavia under its then president, Josip Broz Tito, during the economic crisis of the 1970s. Prior to his death in 1980, Tito had already begun the process of decentralizing federal authority to each of the socialist republics, including Serbia, Croatia, Slovenia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Macedonia, and Montenegro. Around that time, Serbia began jostling for control of the SFRY, but still an integrated socio-cultural climate continued to exist within Bosnia right up until Serbian and Bosnian Serb ethno-nationalist rhetoric entered the discourse in the late 1980s, 1990s. In 1991, Slovenia became the first republic to secede, erupting in a brief 10-day war. It was followed by Croatia and a war with Croatia and Serbia, who fought viciously over 4 years. The Bosnian War was formally declared on April 6, 1992, just a single day before the European Union recognized the country's independence, even though intermittent hostilities had already begun. The Drina Valley, Podrina, is in eastern Bosnia bordering Serbia, and is where the Bosnian Serb Army, the VRS, and associated militias began their ethnic cleansing campaign in early 1991. The picture you're looking at is one of the execution sites in Kozluk, where a mass grave of over 805 men and boys were discovered, one of whom was Hasan's brother. The region was formerly home to 37,000 residents of mixed ethnicities, with a majority of Bosniak inhabitants. In the Srebrenica municipality, in the first 3 months of the war, over 296 villages were ethnically cleansed. In 1993, the Srebrenica enclave was declared one of 6 safe areas by the United Nations, 2 security resolutions, 819 and 824. On July 11, 1995, Srebrenica, under the protection of the Dutch UN peacekeepers, also known as Dutchbat, was overrun by the VRS. Approximately 20 to 25,000 refugees had fled into the neighboring village of Potočari and had gathered in the immediate areas surrounding the peacekeeping compound. Between 5 to 6,000 refugees, mostly women, were allowed entry into the base, but were eventually expelled. The women and girls were forcibly bused to the free territory of Tuzla, while the men and boys were taken to nearby areas and murdered. The last time these families saw one another was on the highway in front of the peacekeeping compound, also known as the Battery Factory, and is the location of the memorial. Meanwhile, a separate column of men, 10 to 15,000 Bosniak men and boys, and a few women, had fled into the mountains between July 11th and 12th, 1995. While a small number of men were able to survive, including Hasan, this would be later become known as the Death March, as over the next 11 days, approximately 8,372 men and boys were subsequently executed by the Bosnian Serb Army. The Dayton Peace Agreement ended the war on November 21, 1995, and Bosnia became one state with two political entities, the Federation of Bosnia and Herzegovina, a coalition between Bosniaks and Croats, and the Republika Srpska, governed by Bosnian Serbs. Srebrenica was assigned to the RS. The Srebrenica genocide is the single largest massacre to take place in Europe since World War II, and it was formally declared genocide by the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia's case against Bosnian Serb Army Deputy General Radislav Krstic. In 2017, Ratko Mladic, the Bosnian Serb Army Colonel General, was found guilty of committing war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide by the ICTY. And the ICTY also convicted Radovan Karadzic, the wartime president of the RS, in 2019, and he was convicted of genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. Now, please join me in welcoming Hasan Hasanović.
Thank you, Laura. I want to thank to all the organizers, all the partners in tonight's program. I was born in a small village 25 kilometers outside of Srebrenica. It was a Muslim village. My father and my grandfather used to work in Croatia. So even though I was a small boy, I had to work the fields. I had to walk a pretty long distances to my school. But living in my village was like a dream. It was a beautiful village. People were helping one another. We produced everything, you know, in our production, on our land. We had our own animals. So I would play, but the most of the time I had to work. But still, life there was beautiful. I lived in Yugoslavia. I remember those times. It was a wonderful country. We lived under the motto of brotherhood and unity. At the time, it didn't matter who you are, and that unfortunately changed when I was about to finish my primary school. I moved to another town with my family because of schooling. We moved to Bratunac, which is another municipality next to Srebrenica. I would come for the weekend to my village where my grandparents, I had two grandfathers and two grandmothers in the same village because my mother got married in the same village. So I would come for the weekend, on the weekends there, you know, to enjoy the nature and see my friends. Living in Bratunac was difficult because all of a sudden the situation had changed dramatically in terms of the politics. We had the first democratic elections in Bosnia. The nationalism revived after the Tito's death, the death of Josip Broz Tito. And all of a sudden, we had war in Slovenia, and then followed by the war in Croatia. We couldn't believe that the war might come over to Bosnia, because you know we lived in such an amazing mixture of different cultures and ethnicities, and we were schoolmates, army mates, neighbors, like brothers and sisters. But in media, one could see that the vision was getting wider and wider, especially from Belgrade, from Milosevic media. And I could feel that in my neighborhood, when my neighbors all of a sudden started to, Serb neighbors started to behave differently because, you know, they were being given orders by the Serb political party, Serb Democratic Party. So all of a sudden, war started in my town. It was occupied. I had to run from Bratunac with my parents. So we ended up in Srebrenica. We stayed there for about 4 years. I found out, you know, that my grandfather committed the suicide. My grandmother died. It's the parents of my father. I visited the village that summer at the beginning of the war, spending two months there, living in forest with people from my village because the village was burned down by our Serb neighbors. So it was hard to see people from my village who had, you know, civilized lives. Many people worked abroad. We had good houses, and they ended up living in that forest like animals. But you know, they wanted to survive the war, and they would later, you know, rebuild their lives. So then I moved. Then I went back to Srebrenica, and my parents came later because of the attack on that forest. So we were again together in Srebrenica. So I felt, and I saw a really difficult, unbelievable starvation that winter 1993, and the end of 1992 was really difficult in terms of food. All the food supplies were cut off for people. So then we started getting airdrops on the initiative of the United States, mainly. I had to go in the forest to fight for food, you know, with refugees. And you could easily get killed. You could easily, you know, get killed by an open parachute. It was really scary. So then, you know, I didn't go to school. You know, I lived under siege. Srebrenica was put under the siege. It was one of the three enclaves in Eastern Bosnia. We could move just in a small circle. You know, everything around was the actual siege. I didn't go to school. Nobody worked. Everything was shut down. You couldn't buy anything. You know, we all depended on humanitarian aid. And you know, if you lived on the in the village, it was easier. Then in March 1993, we were hoping that we would get protection from the United Nations, because Srebrenica was about to be occupied and it could fall any minute. Then the French general Philippe Morion, the commander of the United Nations for Bosnia, came and he promised protection from the United Nations when he was rounded up by refugees. So I was there and I heard his speech when he gave this promise. So we were all very happy, you know, when we heard this promise. He left. So we were waiting for a resolution to be drafted by the UN Security Council. And there was a ceasefire. And I went to the playground a month later to play football. And unfortunately, I survived the massacre that day when 74 kids were killed and over 100 were wounded. One of the shells fell 4 meters in front of me as I sat on those bleachers watching boys playing football. And I fell unconscious. When I woke up after a few minutes, my friends' boys were beheaded, armless, legless. Those who were still alive were screaming. I saw, you know, a lot of blood puddles, and then I ran to nearby home, and then I ran back home. That was first big trauma that I survived, and later I had terrible dreams because of the shell of survived shelling. So, but that was not the end of my suffering. Days later, Srebrenica was proclaimed officially by as a safe UN haven by the UN Security Council. It followed by the arrival of the Canadian battalion. So then later the Dutch battalion, a year later, replaced the Canadian battalion. So living in Srebrenica was tough, even though the United Nations survived. Still, you know, we lived in a very improvised situation. We still depended on humanitarian aid. We couldn't leave the town because of the siege. I did not go to school. I went back to school actually in September 1994 when the school was renovated, reconstructed by one of the Swedish humanitarian organizations. You know, when I went back to school, I felt like that situation was getting back to normal a bit, even though, you know, still it was far away from any normality. So I had a lot of friends. So, you know, there was no electricity. So we would spend time playing music. I went to English schools, which I paid with sugar. You know, food was our currency. We used to exchange food, like a natural exchange of goods. So then in July 1995, Srebrenica was attacked by the Bosnian Serb army in spite of the UN presence of the Dutch battalion. And my mother, grandmother, grandfather, and younger brother went to Potocari outside of Srebrenica, where the main Dutch base was, hoping to be protected there by Dutch soldiers. While I, with my twin brother, my father, and my uncle, we decided to go through the woods in the notorious Death March. So I spent 6 days, six nights running through, you know, being hunted. At the beginning of the march, I lost the sight of my loved ones, and I never saw them again. So they were later captured, executed, killed, you know, and thrown in mass graves. So after, I spent those 6 days thinking of them. I had no food, no water. I was scared all the time. I did not sleep all those nights. I was in a group of many men and boys who were running for their lives. So we were constantly being attacked and shelled. And I could not wrap my head around what was happening to me. I, that was the end of the world. I was not prepared. I was just 19-year-old, very skinny and scared boy. And I thought this could not be at the end of my life. So when I think now, you know, that I'm talking to you and about the book that I wrote with my friend, it's really unbelievable, you know, surviving such unbelievable thing. I survived the death march on this July 16th. I could not wrap my head around what happened to me. You know, I was sobbing. I was, you know, after 2 weeks, I reunited with a part of my family. I found my mother, younger brother, grandparents from the mother's side, but my twin brother and my father and my uncle were not there. I went back to school soon after, like two months later. I spent those 2 months at the airport with refugees. Then later I went back to school. I was taken to as a refugee to another place to live. Nobody even asked me in the school how, you know, it was to survive the genocide, as if it was normal. And it was not normal, of course. Then later I was an interpreter for the U.S. Army when the Dayton Peace Agreement was signed. Later I became a student of one of the faculties in Sarajevo, University of Sarajevo. Then all those years, I was thinking, you know, what happened to my father, my twin brother, my uncle, and when the mass graves were opened, when thousands were exhumed and being identified, I gave a blood sample on behalf of them. And so sadly, we concluded that they were all killed. And I buried my father in 2003 in September. I remember those days, that day, Bill Clinton was inaugurating our memorial. The 20th of September 2003, I came to Bratunac, which is a town in the Republic of Srpska, with the Serb authorities, with the Serb police there. And they stopped us in that town, telling us that there was a traffic jam in the cemetery, that we had to walk for about a mile from the center of that town to the cemetery. So that was not big deal. But what happened later was big deal. As we got off the buses, on both sides of the street, there were lots of, like, hundreds of local Serbs who were yelling at us, calling names, chanting, you know, yelling out unbelievable insults, spitting on us. I was being spat at by even war criminals who I recognized as I was going to bury my father. And I felt absolutely dehumanized, you know, and I had no words to describe how I felt, you know, how much anger was inside of me, which I could not identify at the time, which I will do later. I buried my father, and a couple of years later, actually 2 years later, I buried my twin brother. I had to put his bones with my bare hands, and my heart was pounding, and I thought that I would die because he was my twin. You know, we wore the same clothes. We were both born just like 5 minutes apart, and he was just killed as a student, young student, and thinking, you know, that, you know, he might have been hungry and tortured was devastating to me. And, you know, 4 years later, I returned there to the memorial, to work for the memorial. And I was, you know, psychologically and physically destroyed. But I gathered strength to try to heal myself and to contribute to my country, to the memory, to the world. And this is what I have been doing all these years. I remember times when I had to retell the story for like six times a day, which was tough. Then I spent like 7 years traveling the world, telling the story. I would sometimes tell the story in pairs with Holocaust survivors in the UK. Those were precious times to me. We had unbelievable bonds, speaking in schools together, crying together, talking together. I even made a documentary. I was part of the documentary with one Holocaust survivor. So he came here to our cemetery to be filmed with me and with another survivor. Now what I do at the memorial is research, mainly oral history, filming survivors of the genocide. And this book is, I would say, great contribution because we gave the voices to survivors, and my story is in the book. And I want to say at the end that regardless, you know, what happened to me, I decided to dedicate my life to humanity and human rights. I just want people take my story as a lesson, that young people of this country take my story as a lesson, that hatred is not an option. We need to build a brighter future for our children. We need to reconcile. We need to have denial of genocide to be stopped. It is unacceptable. And I would stop here and pass this on to Laura.
Thank you so much, Hasan. I'm just reminded of the times we sat outside in the memorial in the heat and you talking about your experiences. And I remember when you said, "This will destroy you." So many times we've had that conversation. I'd like to turn it over now to Ann Petrila. Ann, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Lori. You know, listening to my friend and colleague Hasan tell his story, I'm reminded of a time when I didn't really know about Srebrenica. Remember that I had first heard about it in actually July 13th of 95, when I was listening to NPR here in Denver, and Linda Wertheimer was talking about the reports that had started to come out of Bosnia and about a place called Srebrenica, where there were thousands of men and boys who were missing, and it wasn't clear what had happened to them. And now when I think about it, then I didn't really know anything about it, and now I have the unbelievable privilege of calling Bosnia a second home because of two programs that I run there for U.S. graduate students. And now I don't have to wonder anymore because I know what happened to them. And most of what I know about Srebrenica is because of what my friend Hasan has taught me and taught my students. Our paths crossed actually early on in that Hasan had just started working at the memorial the first time I went there. I went to Srebrenica with some Bosnian friends and I met Hasan, who I didn't know at the time he had just started, but he had. And he was telling us about part of his story, which you just heard part of. And so you know how compelling it is and how I just couldn't stop thinking about it and thinking how much I needed to learn more. And I had no idea at that time, of course, that we would become dear friends and colleagues and that we would partner in writing this book so many years later. And I'd been going to Bosnia actually for quite some time with students, and we always went over to Srebrenica, and Hasan was always our teacher. And I realized that I'd reached the point of knowing, I felt like as much as I could know on my own in terms of what I had heard, what I'd read, what I'd learned from people. So I asked Hasan about if he could recommend a book or two on Srebrenica. And he told me that what I was looking for didn't exist at the time, and it certainly didn't exist in English, but that he offered if I could figure out a way to spend a couple weeks around in and around Srebrenica with him, he would teach me everything that he could. And I unfortunately figured out a way to do that. The other thing that I had the privilege of doing, and Laurie, you talked about it in your introduction, of on July 13th, going 1 year with Hasan and Laurie and a few others with the women's associations who were marking the main execution sites and memorializing them. And these execution sites are a field. Laurie showed one in the beginning, with it, which is literally a trash dump, which is a really awful metaphor. And a warehouse, schools, a dam, a cultural center. And it was excruciating for the people who were visiting, the women who had their sons or fathers or husbands or other male relatives executed in these sites. And it was just this raw and unimaginable grief. And I felt so honored to be there. And I also felt so unsure whether I should be there, because this is not my story or my culture. And these were such intimate moments. And this is a question I continue to ask myself in working in cultures other than my own, about how to do this ethically. And it's a question that we should never stop asking ourselves when we're working cross-culturally. One of the speakers that day was a young man named Nejad, who was talking in a school about his survival, and then later at a dam where he had been only one of two survivors of this execution site where 1,500 people had been killed. And I started thinking that, you know, how fortunate again I was to be able to hear these stories, but that only people who had the chance to come to Bosnia and to Srebrenica could hear them at that point. And I kept thinking about this, and then we made our last stop at the Pilica Cultural Center, which is where Hasan's father was killed. And if anyone has seen our book, it's the photo on the cover. It's the worst place I've ever been in my life in terms of the intensity of what you can feel happened in there, and people's fear in there, and their attempts to try to escape what happened. And there were 500 men and boys in there, and nobody survived. So I started to talk to Hasan then at the end of that about, would there be a way to figure out a way to have these stories reach a larger audience outside of Bosnia, if people whose story it was were interested in doing that? And that's how we started the journey of this book. And it took us 5.5 years from start to finish. And the process of doing it was, figuring out who to interview. Of course, Hasan knew most of these people, or if not, someone else knew them. And they all trusted Hasan. And then by extension, they trusted me. So they agreed to meet with us. We met with survivors of the death march, as Hasan had described. We met with survivors of the execution sites. We met with mothers, people who played many other roles in this horrible time in history. And everybody was very interested in wanting to meet with us, as hard as it was for them. And they said over and over they wanted to do this because they wanted the truth to be told and to reach an audience that could learn about their stories, believe their stories, and hopefully play some sort of role of advocacy or in sharing these stories. So the couple of the most important things to me were that we would tell these stories in a way that really presented people in their entirety, people as all of that they are, because they are so much more than their atrocities. You know, people have life experiences. They have wonderful senses of humor. They're generous. They're so resilient. And so to figure out a way to turn all of the transcripted interviews into chapters was always a goal that we kept in mind. And because one, it's not possible to just read atrocity after atrocity, nor would that be fair. Primarily, that was the reason. It's not fair to just identify or have somebody just be told as part of a atrocity that they survived. So I guess in closing, I would say that in addition to the stories of survivors and others in this book, it was also important for us to talk about the trauma that people survived, the ramifications of collective and cumulative trauma, and the lessons learned from Bosnia, because what happened in Bosnia didn't just happen. There was a series of stages of this building up to this genocide, as there always is. And there were so many issues that were happening there that led up to this that are very similar to what we are seeing currently happening in many parts of the world over the last 4 years, certainly in this country, and even now, in terms of nationalism, dehumanizing language, hate speech, all of those things. So we really wanted to make sure that we could provide these sort of lessons learned, because it's so important that we each pay attention. We each need to pay attention to what's happening and figure out our responsibility for addressing human rights violations as soon as they start. Thanks.
Thank you, Anne. And Hasan, I want to invite you on back on to talk. You know, when we're on the phone together, we talk forever. And it feels like, I feel like I'm back with my family. And Bosnia and Srebrenica, as I mentioned, has really changed me. And for many years, I was lost in it. And the toll was quite intense, and it's something I still wrestle with. And I was wondering, Anne, from your perspective, and also Hasan, from your perspective, what has been the toll of going back time and again, and in Hasan's case, you live there, of reaching people who haven't really spoken about this before?
It's a really good question, Lori. And it's doing any kind of work like this, as you know, and anyone who does it knows, I'm speaking now as from my perspective as an outsider. And being, again, welcomed into this incredible place to be able to do this work, I would say it's twofold. One is that it's something that becomes impossible to stop, and nor would I want to stop, because it's, I just feel like if I can somehow use my voice, my privilege, my position, whatever it might be, to walk alongside people who've had this experience and help share what happened in a way that many of them can't share on their own, that I need to do it. I not only need to do it, but I want to do it. And it's the thing that I focus the most on in anything that I do. And it's really hard to do, especially because I care a lot about these people and this story. And I want to be sure to do it right, whatever it is I'm doing. So, but as hard as it is, to be sort of part of it, that pales, of course, in comparison to people who actually experienced it. So, I would say that it does take a toll, and that it's the worst of what humanity can do to each other. And being intimately aware of that and but the honor of being able to do it far outweighs that, the toll.
So what I want to add is that many academics or a number of them have a dilemma, you know, when they interact with survivors or go to places like the cemetery or execution sites, you know, whether they would or should go there because it's not their story. So from my understanding and from how much I know survivors and mothers, and I think I know them, you know, more very well, and we and they want people to come to witness, you know, to bear witness, to see, to understand, and to share the stories to those with those who don't know. Otherwise, I mean, how the world would know? And you know, mothers are always very, you know, welcoming and full of understanding, and they really want people to come to them, to talk to them, and to share their stories. And this is, you know, what I want people to understand. And the other thing is that it's been 26 years since the genocide. I remember at the beginning there was maybe one or a couple of survivors who spoke, like Hasan Hasanović, you know? And so it, now we have, I'm not saying many, but there is a number of survivors who are also advocates for this genocide, for human rights, but also the interest for telling the story in our projects of oral history is growing, you know. And the memorial center in Srebrenica with the new director has done so many good projects which made people to think that they should maybe change their opinions and tell their story. So the trust is being restored, which Memorial had lost, and because I'm working on these projects. So we are hoping that more and more survivors will be able to and will want to tell their stories. And I totally understand the psychological side of it, because I was, I'm a survivor, and I understand how it is difficult, how it was difficult for me at the beginning at the memorial to tell the story. There were times when I thought that I will not survive telling the story. And I understand. So it's our duty to provide conditions, circumstances for survivors to feel comfortable, to feel safe, and to come to us, and they will be safe, and we'll do our best to make sure that, you know, when they tell the story that day, that it's going to be for them a situation where they will feel that they have done something great. You know, after some of these interviews of oral history, many of them said and felt as they should that they had done really unbelievable thing. And I always talk to them about this, and I want them to feel that way, you know.
No, I remember going in to see Remiz Nukic, who also is a survivor, and he frequently finds the bones of victims in the forest where he lives. And going to find him and going up this dirt road and seeing his children, and it's 100 degrees outside. And he's talking about this in sort of this matter of fact way, but we're staring at a femur. And, you know, it's in Bosnia that I first confronted human bones, and going to the identification facility and realizing that when people are recovered, they're recovered as bones. and hundreds of bones. And going to the commemoration each year on July 11th and recognizing that, you know, in the coffins, they're bags of bones. And I wanted to ask this question because, Ann, you mentioned the challenge and sort of the ethical dilemma of being an outsider going to these places. In July 11th commemoration, tens of thousands of people are there, many of whom are not from the community, many of whom their only experience of Srebrenica is then descending upon the town. And there's there's a very big frenzy of catching the right photos and documenting particular stories. And I was wondering if you could both comment on that dimension of the memorialization of this genocide.
Well, I can say from my point of view, I didn't go to the July 11th event for several years that I had been in Bosnia. It would go before or I would go after. And I didn't take my students there because it felt like it was not our place to be there. Because as you said, I think I had gone one time before I took students and it felt, as you were describing, it was a huge event and an international event. And I could see the importance of that because the international press was there. There was, lots of dignitaries, and it was a focus on Srebrenica. And I remember thinking it's really good that there's more of a chance for people to know about Srebrenica. But I also felt like it's also a funeral, and it's a very personal, it's a burial, and so it was it was very uncomfortable. And then it was Hasan who said you have to come to this, and you should bring your students. And he explained why he felt like that was important. And so I started doing that because, again, it's his call of what it is that what we should be doing in terms of joining in or partnering. So now I do take students there when we get to go. You know, we've been grounded for a couple of years, sadly, with COVID. But I'm always certain that we stay outside of the fence where the burial is, that we bear witness as we can, and that we then spend a lot of time talking about what is important in being in those kind of situations that are both a memorialization event and just a big event, I guess. I don't know how else to say it. So
what I want to say is that from the perspective of a survivor, and I usually talk with mothers who I'm very close with, that they want every individual who want and can come to bear witness, and bearing witness of that grief, of that sadness, of the burial is important. But I totally agree that there should be people should in a way be very sensitive in to where to go and. Because the families, especially those burying their loved ones, they need to have their own space where they should not be bothered from photographers, media, from anybody else, you know. But just attending that commemoration, that burial is I think more than necessary for people to just to, you know, see and feel if they can feel. But I think every human being can and should feel it. But again, I think what families do bother, and I find it sometimes inappropriate, is that physical distance of those photographers or media people coming near the faces of those people burying their loved ones. So that is the only thing which I find a little bit troubling, but it's the matter of their ethics. So I'm not going to comment on that one any further. Yeah.
No, I've been, I attended the commemoration many times, and I reached a point where it was too overwhelming, and I felt that it was more important for me to go the other 364 days of the year. Because so much of this memorialization about Srebrenica in the international discourse happens around the major anniversary, but it's much harder to talk about it throughout the rest of the year. I wanted to mention just a few points. Jasmila Zvanic, she's a Bosnian director, and her film Quo Vadis Aida, has been nominated for an Academy Award in Best International Feature. And this might be a watershed moment for the memorialization of this genocide, because, and it could put Srebrenica on the map in a similar way to what Schindler's List did for the Holocaust in sort of popular memory, if you will. I also wanted to ask something, and this came up in our conversation yesterday, Hasan. We're often talking about victims and survivors as if these two terms are interchangeable. And you talked about how you actually, you have a reaction to that. And I wanted you to just talk a little bit about it.
So how I see it, and from the, I would say, very beginning, it's not just like now. That you know, I'm survivor. I'm not a victim. For me, victims are those who were killed, who are either buried or still need to be identified or exhumed and identified and buried. Survivors, especially in this case of Srebrenica genocide, and both men and women have. Shown unbelievable resilience, dignity, courage, and this is why I think that term "survivor" is appropriate, and the term "victim" is more pitiful. You know, like I don't want people to feel sorry for me. You know, or I think that all these. Women and the men, they you know, have shown unbelievable dignity. So I think people sometimes make mistakes, you know, when they use these terms, and they should be careful.
No, I absolutely agree. And I think that in some respects, it's more complicated, and I want to link to something, which is, you know, in when we're talking about Bosnia, especially in the international community, there's victims, there's survivors, there's perpetrators. We don't spend as much time talking about the gray in between, and there's many different ethnicities in Bosnia besides the three constituent peoples of Croats, Muslims, and Serbs. There's also a large Roma and Sinti community. There's, you know, a Jewish community. But I wanted to ask another question in terms of, you know, there is so much denial that is rife, and it continues. I think it was recently a politician in Montenegro is now denying the genocide. Could you talk a little bit about the challenges of reconciliation and transitional justice and what this means for you when you're going home and you're around people who you know have been involved in the murder and torture of your family?
I don't want to sound political, but this is the political problem. In my understanding, the genocide was committed because of political decisions. So we have the verdicts established by the ICTY and the ICJ, and we know what happened. So there is this world's consensus: what happened here in Srebrenica was the genocide. Everybody accepted as genocide, but not our neighbors. I'm talking about political elites of Serbia and this autonomy of Bosnia called Republika Srpska. So they have never given up on the ideology of the Greater Serbia. So they have been celebrating war criminals. It's almost a part of their folklore. You know, celebrating them. They teach their children that they are heroes, not war criminals. In their education curriculums, they teach them that the war that they led was for liberation of Serbs. They've done nothing wrong. They are victims themselves, you know. So in media, this narrative is being constructed. And people, you know, when you talk to Serbs, they have this, each one of them have the same opinion on every particular matter. So you can tell that it's being constructed by the collective memory and politicized by the elites. So this all reflects on the ordinary people. It reflects and affects our relations in our community. Serb people living in Srebrenica, they say they follow this discourse in denial. denying that this ever happened, even though they drive through the by the cemetery, they see over 7,000 of gravestones, but they follow that narrative of denial. You know, even though they know that I had my father, my twin brother, my uncle, but they still say it never happened. But I think, honestly, when they go to bed, this is, you know, for public, but for privacy, their privacy, they know what happened, but they are afraid to tell it because everything is being monitored by their political party. So if they go out and speak and admit and say something or do something, they will be attacked. They lose in their jobs, you know. So they'll have to move from and where to move, you know. And if you lose the job in Bosnia, I mean, you are done. It's not as simple as that. So in terms of reconciliation, it, in my opinion, should start from the top. You know, once Vucic and political elites in Serbia, once they decide to go into this process, to recognize, admit this genocide, to educate people in schools, to approach the families of genocide, to survivors. So then, you know, when they pass laws banning denial of genocide, then they in a way create conditions for ordinary people to feel more comfortable to talk to one another. And then situation will settle. You know, I think ordinary people are ready, but politicians are not ready. So this is that problem, which people don't understand. You know, and one has to be here for a while to understand this.
I wanted to ask you one more question. It's come through from the audience, but it actually builds on something we were talking about right before we got on. And it was recovery for you. You were mentioning a person that you had recently been talking to who was having these dreams and recently had a catharsis. And I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about that, because it really, I think, speaks to sort of the trajectory of trauma and how you've worked through some of these things, but how it absolutely still lingers.
We had... less than 2 years ago, we had a project, actually a year and a half ago, when Emir became director of the memorial, we had immediately a project with Sarajevo Childhood Museum, filming 100 people who were children during the genocide. And we had psychotherapist, you know, and she used EMDR. So this was the first time when I had two sessions of EMDR, which helped me really, you know, big time. And survivors, you know, could not stop talking about that, you know. And it's been 26 years since, and survivors have never been given this services from the authorities. And there is also that stigma and the sort of it's a shame to admit that you have psychological problems, you know. As if, you know, those problems coming from the genocide are equal to problems in normal life, which is not true. So nothing has changed in that sense, and nothing has been given to survivors. And if somebody would ask me, you know, what do you need in Bosnia, I would say we need EMDR or any other therapy that would help us to cope more easily with our trauma. And it's as we get older, it becomes a bigger problem, and nothing has been done. You know, us as survivors, we are not treated in any law of this country. You know, I am as any other citizen of this country, and I think this has and needs to change, you know, and it's not on the agenda of politicians, and it needs to be. And it's not, you know, on the agenda of some human rights organizations, NGOs. They never advocate for this issue. There are some tiny, tiny organizations that try to do something, but we need something big, you know. We need people to feel that they have this. It's not just like 1% or less. So this really has a need to change. And I've seen a lot of survivors going through PTSD. They had so many problems. They created problems for their families. And this needs to be addressed. And this needs to be resolved in a way that the survivors are given this service that they deserve and should be given and all.
No, I absolutely agree. I've always felt going to Bosnia, you can feel the trauma. You can see it. There's scars all over the buildings, but with every single person you interact with, there is definitely this pressure. And I mean, we're going through it in our own society right now and the mental health crisis that's, you know, just expanded and through COVID. And I wanted to ask you one question, which is you bring students to Srebrenica and to Bosnia each year. And I was wondering if you could talk about what the transformation that they go through. And if you were, when you teach about Srebrenica, what's the most important thing to get across to students?
I would say the transformation is pretty much across the board the same each year in even students who are well-versed in genocide or they're of a particular group themselves where their family has been, decimated from genocide or they've spent time in other places, even those students, and then down to students who really knew nothing about Bosnia before we started the class, the transformations take a couple different forms. One is they don't know even how to express their gratitude about the openness and graciousness and willingness of people in Bosnia to have us be with them during the time that we're there and to teach us and to hang out with us and feed us and laugh with us and then also share these incredibly difficult stories. So I think that they're so that's part of what I'm about to say next, which is the transformation of really a perspective shift in terms of what is a problem, what is really something that is feels insurmountable for real, and also then the similarities between the human rights violations early on in a place where civil society is starting to unravel and the similarities of that and their feeling of responsibility of being more aware of that here and elsewhere and figuring out their role in that. So that is, I would say, the transformation. And I almost to a student, they want to come back, they stay in touch, they do come back. They always beg me the next year, can they come as my assistant? That really wanting to come back. And our time in Srebrenica is one of the most impactful times for sure. And then in terms of what's the most important thing for them to know, if I have to say one thing, it is that it's our obligation before we go to learn as much as we can, to realize that that is just the scratching the surface and that when we're there is when the true learning will happen. And we have to approach this with openness and humility.
No, I absolutely agree. And I think the theme in these last few minutes that we're talking about comes down to people's hearts and souls and bearing witness and seeing people in Bosnia. It is not just a country of war. It's an absolutely beautiful country. And I've had some of the most profound experiences with friends and people who are like family. And I wanted to, we wanted to just remember someone right now who's been an integral part of this community. It's Atija Mehmetovic. She was one of the mothers of Srebrenica. I'm gonna put up her photo now. She passed away on July 22nd, 2018. And the first time I met her was in 2011 and it was hot. We were at the memorial, it was a July summer. And she was with a group of women who were there for a monthly memorial service. And she agreed to speak with me. And we had subsequently been on the bus through the countryside visiting the execution sites. And I remember one particular occasion, she held my hand on the bus and was showing me her wedding ring, which she never took off, even though her husband was murdered. And we wanted to pay tribute to her. She lived in Srebrenica, she never left the community. And whenever she would meet with groups of students and people wanting to know more, she always asked the question, what are you doing for Srebrenica? And today is a chance for myself personally to give back in a way. And Anne, I wanted to turn the floor over to you because you and Hasan wrote something quite beautiful about her.
Thank you. She, I remember when she died, and I had been, I was in Bosnia with students and had, so we were students during the week. Then I'd been over to Srebrenica almost every weekend because we were working full speed ahead on this book. And I had just gotten back actually into Sarajevo when Hasan called and said that she had died and invited me to come back for her service, her funeral. So of course I did that and was very honored to do so. And then in talking about our book, we decided that a tribute to Hatice was the best way to finish our book. So I'd like to just read a small part of the final chapter, which is about Hatice. Hundreds of people gathered for Hatice's memorial service and funeral. People who spoke talked about how she had started the Mothers of Srebrenica Association after losing her husband, two sons, two brothers, and other family members in the genocide. Speakers described Hatice as the mother of all children, regardless of their national identity, race, or heritage, who fought for justice until the last day. Her death was covered by media from around the world, including the Washington Post, the New York Times, ABC News, and the Irish Independent. The tributes to her at her memorial service were echoed in numerous articles that praised her benevolence and her tireless advocacy. Closer to home, unfortunately, the vice president of the Serbian parliament sent out this tweet mocking Hatice's death. Quote, I've just read that Hatice has died. I wonder who will bury her, her husband or her sons. These vile words sparked outrage. This is the world in which the Bosnian Muslims live. Even people who are respected and praised around the world are met with ridicule and disdain in the Republic of Srpska and in Serbia. They are assaulted sometimes daily with genocidal denial and mockery of their experiences. They are saddled with the political system that allows this to happen. How they remain such good, kind, generous people amid such relentless abuse and indignity will forever be a mystery to me. When Hasan heard the news about Hatice's death, he wrote a lovely tribute. My heart broke and my soul crashed when I heard that our dearest Hatice passed away last night. I have spent years with her at the memorial and she always called me son. She was the head of the Mothers of Srebrenica Association and a genuine advocate for the victims of the Srebrenica genocide, both in the country and abroad. You will always be my hero and my ultimate inspiration. I already miss you, my dearest Hatice. We will never forget you and will keep on doing all that you have fought for all these years. On the day of the funeral, Srebrenica was overflowing with people. Seeing how they cared for each other, how they laughed and talked after the service, I was reminded, as I always am, of Bosnia's true essence. It is a place of beauty and sorrow, unspeakable tragedy and horror, solidarity and generosity, graciousness of spirit, and a resilience that allows so many people to somehow continue moving forward day after day. Survivors are on the front line of fighting for justice on a daily basis, and they will never stop. This is Srebrenica winning.
Thank you so much, Anne. And I want to thank you, Hasan. This has been a really powerful conversation, and I'm just so grateful to collaborate with you both. And I feel like you're here with me. I'm staring off camera and I'm looking at your book and just really overwhelmed with it. You know, we've looked at so many books together over the years, and it's just written so well. And it is really a testament to the heart and the soul and the love that not only you bring to this conversation, but that we should all bring when we're talking about Bosnia and we're talking about other communities who have suffered genocide and atrocities, that it is also about life and memory. So I want to thank you both. We're going to end now. We want to thank all our sponsors for today's event. We hope everyone stays safe and well. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.